Good morning, class. Today we'll be doing the topic cheating under IPC, which is dealt from section 415 to 420 of Indian Penal Code. Now, as a layman, what do you mean by cheating? Cheating is basically a criminal offense wherein there is a dishonest intention of a person to gain undue advantage over the other. That is a layman language. But if we see under Section 415 of Indian Penal Code, cheating is defined as whoever by deceiving any person fraudulently, deceiving means to cheat, or dishonestly induces the person so deceived to deliver any property to any person, or to consent that any person shall retain any property, or intentionally induces the person so deceived to do or omit to do anything which he would not do if he were not so deceived, and which act or omission causes or likely to cause damage or harm to that person in body, mind, reputation, or property is said to cheat. So basically, cheating is defined under Section 415 of Indian Penal Code. Now, the explanation of cheating says there is a dishonest concealment of facts, and that is equal to deception. That means you are hiding the facts deliberately from the other person, so and you are making him to believe something which is not true. Then that is called as cheating. For example, A sold an article to B, saying that it is made up of gold, although it was not made up of gold. Then that is cheating. Now, constituents of cheating are you have. There is should be a dishonest act, which is down the word dishonestly is defined under Section 24 IPC. Then there has to be a property. Property is a wider thing. It does not only include money, but other things which can be measured in terms of money. The property should be in a complete ownership of a person. That means you should have a full right over that property, and only then only you can put the other person in charge of cheating. Then fraudulently. Being fraudulent means which involves deception, mainly criminal deception. It is characterized by fraud. According to Section 25 of IPC, a person is said to do a thing fraudulently if he does that thing with an intent to defraud, but not otherwise. Then there has to be a mens rea to constitute this crime. Then there has to be the guilty. Mens rea and actus rea both to constitute the offense of cheating. Now, Section 416 talks about cheating by personation. Now, what do you mean by personation? Means pretending. Wherever you pretend as if you are some other person and you represent that other person, although you are not actually that other person. The offense is committed where the individual is you are personating as some real or some imaginary person. For example, A by falsely pretending to be a government official deceives B and induces B to sell a property to him, for which A knows that he will not going to pay B for that. Then A cheats by personation. Section 417 talks about punishment of cheating. Cheating is punishable under this section with imprisonment up to 1 year or fine or both. Imprisonment depends upon quantum of act done. If the act is not that grave, imprisonment won't be imposed and will charge with only fine only. But when the act done is so grave that merely fine and imprisonment won't compensate, then the person will be charged for mandatory imprisonment for a term which may extend to 7 years and fine. Now, Section 418 says cheating with the knowledge that wrongful loss may be caused to other person and which he is bound to protect. Under this section, whoever cheats with the knowledge that there is likely thereby to cause wrongful loss to other person whose interest in the transaction to which the cheating relates, he was found either by law or any legal contract to protect, shall be punished with imprisonment of either description for a term which may extend to 3 years or fine or both. Now, causing loss to the aggrieved parties whose interest is to be protected by the offender, and if he omits to do it with wrongful intention, then it is amount to cheating. That means you were liable or you were bound to protect the other person's property and still you have not done that, then it amounts to cheating. 419 talks about punishment of cheating by personation. See, cheating by personation was explained in 416. However, punishment is described under 419, which can extend to imprisonment for a term which extend to 3 years of fine for both. The punishment for cheating is defined under Section 420, wherein This section deals with offenses which are committed by person by cheating another person and inducing him to deliver his property to the offender. According to this section, whoever cheats and thereby dishonestly induces the person deceived any property to any person or to make, alter or destroy the whole or any part of the valuable security or anything which is signed or sealed and which is capable of being converted into valuable security shall be punished with the imprisonment of either description for a term which may extend to 7 years and shall also be liable for fine. Now, what are the ingredients of section 420? First is cheating. Second is that there has to be a dishonest intention to take the property or to induce any person to alter, destroy or make changes in the property. Then malintention. Now, there are various modes of cheating. For example, caste misrepresentation. Or for example, you are belonging to one caste and you misrepresent the other person that you by telling him the wrong caste, or showing false accounts, or creating false evidence, that is also cheating, or false professional qualifications, showing some wrong documents. All these things amount to cheating. Now there is a question whether breach of contract amounts to cheating. It is mentioned under section 415 to 420 that and it is also mentioned under section 73 of Indian Contract Act. It is dealt under criminal law and also dealt under civil law. Civil law is Contract Act and 415 to 420 is criminal law. It is dishonest act done in order to gain advantage over the other. It cause of action which occurs when binding agreement is not performed. Then that means when there is a breach of contract, where there is a promise to constitute a part of contract or a contract and you do not perform the contract with a malintention, then that amounts to cheating. In this case, S.W. Palanthikar versus State of Bihar, in this case, Supreme Court held that to convict a person for offense of cheating, there should be a pre-existing dishonest or fraudulent intention of the person from beginning. And in breach of contract, the dishonest intention is not needed in the beginning. It can be present in the beginning of the agreement. That means you want to cheat the other person and therefore only you made the contract. Now, fraud and cheating is almost same. That is when your cheating is done with a fraudulent intention only. Now, if there is a dishonest act done in order to gain advantage over the other, it is a by a deliberate deception to gain unfair advantage over the other, to cause loss to the other, then it will be amounting to cheating under section 105. Cheating is, however, not only limited to contracts. It can be under dishonor of check, wherein under section 138 of Negotiable Instrument Act, wherein the check is dishonored deliberately. That means you do not have the money in the account and you still give a check to some other person, and thereby because you wanted to cheat, so cheating was there in your mind since beginning. For example, if the person who has issued a check has already closed the bank account, then issues a check, then that will amount to cheating because check will be bounced. The offense under 138 Negotiable Instrument Act and section 420 are two different offenses altogether. Whether this offense or that offense is made out would depend on the facts of the case. Then you have to check the ingredients or the facts of the case. Now, legal remedies for the offense of cheating. First, under section 2 of IPC, it is stated every person shall be liable to punishment under this code and not otherwise for every act or omission contrary to the provision thereof for which he is guilty within India. For example, if a Pakistani comes to India and falsely represents himself as a businessman of Bombay, he assured the complainant that he is having good quality of products and he would be glad to sell them to the complainant if he transfers monies to him. The complainant transferred the money but did not receive anything in return. It was held the offense was committed in Bombay. Even though the accused is a Pakistani, still he will be liable by virtue of section 2 of IPC. Now, if we see the cognizance of offense, the offense of cheating is cognizable and non-bailable. FIR is done in these kind of complaints. There are certain minor cases of cheating where the imprisonment is just for 1 year. That is where the cheating is not very much severe. But however, there are very severe cases of cheating also, like cheating done by guardian, trustee in a Hindu family. In those cases, the imprisonment can extend to 3 years or both. In cheating in case of personation also, the punishment is up to